Once again, good afternoon, everyone. So our theme for this young people's meeting is Send the Light. We're going to be learning a lot about some people in history who shone their lights all around the world. But first, we're going to start with the children's program. So I'd like to ask them to come forward, and they have some songs and verses for us.
For it's written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Matthew 4:4.
Enter ye in the straight gate, for wide is the gate, and the broad is the way that leadeth to direction, and many there be which go in thereat. Because straight is the gate, and narrow is the way that leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it.
Amen.
Thank you.
Beautiful the little hands that fulfill the Lord's commands. Beautiful the little eyes, kindled with the light from the skies. All the little hands were made Jesus' precious cause to aid. All the little hearts to beat, one is service so sweet. All the little lips should pray to the Savior every day. All the little feet should go swift from his hands below. What your little hands can do, that the Lord attends for you. Make that thing your first delight, do it with all your might. Thy word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against thee.
Jesus, I will follow thee, for I heard thee calling me. Love and trust and glad I come to thy doing and help.
Ye know why my lose thy ways, ye know if in my go astray, I might meet him where we beat with the watch over me.
What can I give him for a share in the shepherd of the world that I might not make it? So what can I give him and give him my heart?
Jesus, you are my heart, understanding every part. When I'm looking or I play, all I do is on display. You know everything I say, particularly night and day.
Darkness is like light to you. You see everything I do. In my mommy, you did see my tiny form becoming me. I praise you, amazing God. You are great and I am awed.
Before I made a wind of valley, I knew you.
I have taught thee the way of wisdom. I have led thee right path.
But the path of the just
Christ is like the shining light that shineth more and more until the perfect day.
I bow at his feet and I pray that I may realize his watch care over all of my members each day. For what is more wonderful truly, the physical laws God has made, each fiber and earth of my being has on it those principles laid.
What, know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which ye have of God, and ye are not your own? For ye are bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's.
Okay, at this point, we'd like to invite all the young people and the children who've been practicing songs to come and join the children up here to sing the last couple of songs.
Missionary band, missionary band, missionary band, we are.
children and all the youth. That was very nice. And they're all here yesterday working very hard to prepare these songs for us today. So we're going to have our first presentation this afternoon. I'd like to ask Alex to come forward. He's going to tell us about George Mueller.
Good afternoon, everyone. Today I will be doing a presentation about George Mueller. George Mueller was a Christian evangelist and a director of orphanages in England. He cared for 10,024 orphans in his life and was well known for providing an education to the children under his care. He also established 117 schools which offered Christian education to over 120,000 children, many of them orphans. Early years. Mueller was born in a village near Halberstadt in the Kingdom of Prussia, today known as Germany. His early life was not marked by good deeds. He was a thief, a liar, and a gambler. While his mother was dying, he, at 14 years of age, was playing cards with friends and drinking. At 16, Mueller was imprisoned for defrauding the hotel owner. Mueller's conversion. Mueller was studying divinity in the University of Halle and met a fellow student, Beda, who invited him to a Christian prayer meeting. Mueller was welcome to the meeting and enjoyed it so much that he began regularly studying the Bible, reading the Bible. After seeing a man at one of these meetings praying to God on his knees, he was totally convinced of his need for salvation. As soon as he got home, he went to his bed and knelt and prayed. He asked God to help him in his life and to bless him wherever he went and to forgive him his sins. He immediately stopped drinking, stealing, and lying, and began hoping to become a missionary. He also began preaching regularly in nearby churches. Mueller's experience. I became a believer in the Lord Jesus in the beginning of November 1825. I gave myself fully to the Lord, honors, pleasures, money, my physical powers, my mental powers, all were laid down at the feet of Jesus, and I became a great lover of the Word of God. My knowledge of God and His Word is that which helps me. Mueller goes to England. Mueller wanted to become a missionary and in 1828 offered to work with Jews in England, promoting Christianity among the Jews. However, on arriving in England, he became very sick and doctors did not think he would survive. When he did recover, he dedicated himself to doing the will of God and became a pastor in Devon, England. Depending on God. In 1830, George Mueller married Mary Groves. 3 weeks after their marriage, they decided to depend upon God alone to provide their needs and never to ask for money and to also never go into debt. At the time of need, there would always seem to be funds available from some source, both in regards to their private income and to the funds for his vast project. Missionary work. In 1834, he founded an organization to support orphanages, distribute Bibles, and support missionaries such as Hudson Taylor around the world. George Mueller never asked for money from anyone, never fundraised, and received no government support. Yet this organization received and disbursed approximately $2.7 million during Mueller's lifetime. Entirely through faith and prayer. Orphanages. The work of Mueller and his wife with orphans began in 1836 when they opened their own home to provide a home to 30 girls. By 1870, 1,722 children were accommodated in five homes. Through all this, Mueller never asked for money, nor did he go into debt. Many times, he received unsolicited food donations only hours before they were needed to feed the children. For example, one time, they gave thanks for breakfast when all the children were sitting at the table. Even though there was nothing to eat in the house, as they finished praying, the baker, followed by the milkman, knocked on the door with sufficient fresh bread and milk to feed everyone. At the orphanages, every morning after breakfast, there was a time of Bible reading and prayer. Whenever a child left the orphanage, they were given a Bible and a tin trunk with two changes of clothes. God's Word. It was Mueller's practice in later years to read through the entire Bible four times a year. In his lifetime, he read the Bible through over 200 times. Final years. In 1875, at the age of 70, Mueller began 17 years missionary traveling. During this time, he preached to more than 3 million people in over 40 countries, including Great Britain, Europe, Canada, United States, the Middle East, Australia, New Zealand, Japan, and China. In 1892, he returned to England, where he died on March 10, 1898. Final years. His influence touched the lives of thousands, and his testimony is an inspiration to Christians everywhere. When he died in March 1898, he had obtained from God more money than anyone else who ever lived, $7.5 million. Amen.
Thank you, Alex. It's amazing to see how through the Holy Spirit, someone can go from such a difficult life to one of service to the Lord. So now we will move on to our next item, which will be an instrumental item, "When Peace Like a River."
Thank you.
to our second presentation, which is about James Hudson Taylor, and I'd like to ask Martin to come forward.
Well, as Nicole said, my presentation is on James Hudson Taylor, who is a missionary and a man of God. Thank you. Okay. His early life. Hudson was born on the 21st of May, 1832, into a good Christian family in Barnsley, England. Once, when he was 4 years of age, he said, "When I'm a man, I mean to be a missionary and go to China." This must have made his parents very happy, because that is exactly what they prayed for their son to be a missionary to China. When it was time for him to go to school, his parents held him back. He wasn't very strong, so he was educated at home until he was 11. It was when he went to school that he lost his faith. When he was 15, he got a job as a junior clerk at the local bank. He was a popular teen and was led further astray by bad influences. His conversion. 2 years later, when he was 17, he was at home and decided that he wanted to read something. So he went to his father's library. After searching around for a bit, he found a gospel tract called "It Is Finished" and decided to read it. While reading, he came across the expression, "the finished work of Christ," and remembering the words, "It is finished," he asked the question, "What was finished?" The answers, "Christ's atoning work," then found a place and he received Christ as his Savior. And as a little interesting note, at the time of his conversion, his mother was visiting some 75 miles away. She suddenly felt the need to pray for a wayward son, so she knelt on her knees and decided not to leave the spot until the prayer had been answered. Hours later, she arose rejoicing, knowing that her prayer had been answered. This took place at the same time and afternoon that her son had his conversion. After his conversion. Some months later, Hudson was dissatisfied with his spiritual state. He felt that he had lost his first love, and his zeal for souls had grown cold. He then retired to his room to be alone with the Lord. He thanked God for saving him and asked him what he should do. Later on, he felt impressed by God to become a missionary to China. Missionary in training. Hudson tried to prepare himself in every possible way for the life of a missionary in China. He began doing missionary work in the area he lived. He started learning the Chinese language. And he even joined a medical course, knowing that if he were able to help the sick, he would have a better chance to help people who are sin sick. Hudson Taylor left England on the 19th of September, 1853. His mother and a few friends boarded the ship with him, and in his cabin they prayed, sang, and read a song. His family and friends went back to shore. He said to his mother, "Dear mother, do not weep. It is but for a little while, and we shall meet again. Think of the glorious object I have in leaving you. It is not for wealth or fame, but to try to bring the poor Chinese to the knowledge of Jesus." As the ship sailed away, he climbed a mast that he might have a longer view of his family and friends on the shore. He waved his hat while they waved their handkerchiefs until they were out of sight. Hudson was on his way to China. His arrival. Hudson arrived in Shanghai on the 1st of March, 1854, after a voyage of 5.5 months, including a close encounter with cannibals and 2 shipwrecks. Here's a quote from Hudson on how he felt when he arrived. "My feelings on stepping ashore I cannot describe. My heart felt as though it had not room and must burst its bounds. The bonds, with tears of gratitude and thankfulness, fell from my eyes." Living in China. Pretty soon after his arrival, Hudson decided he should wear Chinese dress and grow pigtail, which in those days was quite radical. And sadly, he was mocked for this decision. He wore baggy trousers, white calico socks, satin shoes, and to complete the costume, a loose silk gown with wide sleeves. On a number of occasions, this decision saved his life because he attracted less attention, and it helped him to identify more with people. The interior. Hudson went to the international settlement. It was a settlement geared for foreigners, and what he saw there horrified him. Instead of seeing hard-working, godly missionaries, he saw idleness and heard sarcastic and rude remarks. He worked in that area for a number of years, then due to political tensions, he moved further into the interior. Maria Dyer. During the course of Hudson's work, he became acquainted with Maria Dyer, the orphan daughter of a former missionary to China. She was also busy in missionary work. She and Hudson were quite interested in each other before they courted. They then courted for a while, and those around them did not approve of the match, and a sort of guardian to Miss Dyer persuaded her to reject him. She was reluctant to do so, but she did it nonetheless. A while later, he proposed again and was accepted. They were engaged for about 2 years. They were married in 1859. They continued their work together for many years, enjoying being able to witness together for the Lord. Hudson's family. Hudson and Maria had 9 children. Sadly, 4 died at a young age and 1 was stillborn. Maria died of TB on the 23rd of July, 1870. She was buried in Chongqing, I think. Okay, thank you. He met Miss Folding in July of 1871, and they were married sometime later in the same year. They had 2 children and adopted a little girl. In conclusion, Hudson left his heart in China, just like Livingstone in Africa. He had been in England, but returned to China a few months before he died. Hudson died in the city of Changsha, Hunan, China, the province of Hunan, China, on the 3rd of June, 1905. Over the years, he made 11 trips to China, established 20 mission stations, brought 849 missionaries to China, trained 700 Chinese workers, raised $4 million by faith, and developed a witnessing church of 125,000. What we can learn from Hudson. He learned to trust and be completely dependent upon God. He learned the power of prayer while working for the Lord. He learned how to walk in the light that he had. He learned how to owe no man anything. He learned how to love the people he worked for. And finally, he learned how to glorify God through his obedience. And here's a quote that I thought was quite proper for this theme today. There are 3 stages in the work of God: impossible, difficult, and done. Thank you.
Thank you, Martin. I hope you're all listening, because I know in tomorrow's activities, one of the clues is about Hudson Taylor. It actually goes for all the presentations, so make sure that you listen to all the presentations very well. Our next item today is going to be Ina, and she has a song for us on the accordion.
Thank you.
much. It's always nice to hear you play the accordion, and that was such a lovely song. So I'll move on to our third presentation, and I'd like to ask Carolina, and she's going to be telling us about Mary Slessor.
Hello. So my presentation is on Mary Slessor. So she was a Scottish missionary who served for Jesus in Africa. She was born on December 2nd in 1848. Her father was an alcoholic, and unfortunately he had to stop shoemaking, and he later became a mill laborer. Her mother made sure that she attended church frequently and arranged for her schedule that she would work at the mill part of the day and the other part of the day to go to school. As Mary got older, she became very interested in Christianity. She joined a local mission teaching poor people in her hometown. There's a very famous story about her. It was about when this group of boys dared her that she couldn't stand still while they swung a heavy metal weight towards her face, but she stood still the whole time, so they had to go to Bible school in return of the bet. But funnily enough, they enjoyed Bible school, so they kept coming. It became clear to the church elders that she was perfect for missionary work. When she was 27, she felt that there was more to life than just working in a cotton mill. After her longtime hero, David Livingstone, had died, she was determined to go forward just like him. So 2 years later, she hopped on a boat to go to Africa. The trip to Africa was long and hard, and she got sick several times before she arrived to Calgary. Once she was there, she realized that it wasn't going to be very easy to teach them about Jesus, but she was determined, and she decided to live there among the Efik people in Calgary, which is today known as Nigeria. After 3 years of working missionary work at Calgary, she wanted to go more into the interior of Africa, where no other white person has ever settled before. Unfortunately, she had gotten malaria. She was sick of malaria for over 1.5 years, and she even had to return to Scotland to recover. God still had the plans for her to recover, and gladly she did. She was able to return to Calgary and go to a town more inland called Old Town. In Old Town, the people weren't used to her appearance, but after a while getting to know her and getting comfortable with her, they began to refer to her as White Mom. There, the locals left babies at her doorstep, and there she took care of them because they left for them to die. In Old Town, it was considered a curse to have twins, so Mary would go in the middle of the night and snatch the babies before the killers could get them and take care of them in her orphanage. She also adopted one of the twin girls and named her Janie and raised her as her own. Mary chose to live among the poor villagers there. She wanted to earn their respect and trust so that she could better her work. She eventually did earn their trust, and she was able to overcome customs such as killing twin babies and cannibalism. Mary died in Calabar in Nigeria in 1915. She was regarded as the Queen of Calabar. She was given a state funeral by the people who loved her very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Carolina. That was a really interesting story about a missionary who was inspired by other missionaries. So we'll move on to our next item, which is, I'd like to ask all the youth who play their instruments, we're going to be playing the song Shining Just Like Stars.
Thank you.
thank you all again. This was another song that we just started rehearsing last night, and I'm very happy with everyone's participation. Thank you. We'll move on to our final presentation, and I'd like to ask Helena to come forward, and she's going to be telling us about Sister Ellen White.
Good afternoon. So I will be speaking to you about Ellen White. And I think we've know quite a bit about, probably more than the other missionaries we talked about today. But I think it's important to go over. I think she's a very good example of everything we've been studying this weekend. So first off, who was Ellen G. White, and why did millions consider her writings of special value and importance? So Ellen was a woman of remarkable spiritual gifts who lived from 1827 to 1915. In the early years, Ellen and her twin sister Elizabeth were the youngest of eight children born to Robert and Eunice Harmon. When the twins were born on November 26, 1827, the family lived on a farm near Gorham, Maine. A few years later, Robert Harmon gave up farming and moved the family to Portland, where he worked out of his home making hats. The whole family, including young Ellen, helped with hat making. So I put this in here because I don't know about you, but it's kind of an interesting idea to me to think about young Ellen doing such a humble task, hat making, when you consider what a great work she did later on in life. But in reality, no task, no work is too humble for us. And I think the humblest of work can teach the greatest of life lessons. So I think that's something that we should take away and perhaps consider doing in our own lives. The Great Disappointment. Ellen was among those who heard the Advent message from young Miller and experienced the Great Disappointment of 1844. Following the Great Disappointment, God used Ellen to encourage Advent believers. Many times when we are disappointed in life, it hits us pretty hard. As Brother Alex mentioned this morning during the morning worship, many times, give up in a way, some of us, right? It's just too difficult, we're disappointed, and that's it, that's the end of it. But we cannot allow our disappointments to hinder us from being that light. I can think of no greater disappointment than not seeing Christ face to face when you expectedly waited so long to see him. But we should take a lesson from Ellen. She did not allow the great disappointment to stop her from completing the mission God had for her. She still continued to accept the light God gave her and shine it on to others. So we should do the same. We should, when we have disappointments, we should not allow them to get us down, not allow us to do the task we've been asked to do. God's Messenger. When Ellen was 17, she began her mission as God's Messenger. Ellen saw in her vision the travels of the Advent people to the City of God and shared her visions with others. She traveled to churches and camp meetings around the world to share God's messages and to encourage Advent believers. From the time she was 17 years old until she died 70 years later, God gave her approximately 2,000 visions and dreams. The visions varied in length from less than a minute to nearly 4 hours. Ellen's writings. During her lifetime, Ellen wrote more than 5,000 articles and 40 books. Today, including compilations from her 50,000 pages of writing, more than 100 titles are available in English. Her writings cover a wide range of subjects, including religion, education, social relationships, evangelism, prophecy, publishing, nutrition, and management. In reality, there's something for everyone. A special messenger. Ellen is the most translated woman writer in the entire history of literature and the most translated American author. Her life-changing book on successful Christian living, Steps to Christ, has been published in more than 140 languages. Sister White was more than a gifted writer. She was appointed by God as a special messenger to draw the world's attention to the Holy Scriptures and help prepare people for Christ's second coming. She also made very many missionary trips to England, Germany, France, Italy, Denmark, Norway, and Sweden. The two trips to the Waldensian valleys in Italy, where she visited places she had seen in vision, were particularly interesting to her. It must have been quite interesting for her. She'd seen these places in vision and now to see them in person. She also lived in Australia from 1891 to 1900, where she continued to labor for the Lord. So these are the facts. Now, it's a very short presentation, but as I conclude, I'd like to remind us of a few things. So first off, when she began her mission, she was 17 years old. That's very young. Who here is 17 or around that age? Hands up. Heidi, there we go. So there's a couple of you here. That's how young Ellen White was when she began her mission. So that's how young she was. So we're never too young to work for the Lord. Right? Now, let's also consider that she worked from then onward until she passed away. She was 87 when she died. So, who's over 80? I know at least one person who is. Baka Ivanka? Right? There you go.
She doesn't feel that way.
It's okay. It's better that way. But you see, we're never too old to work for the Lord either. And you can say, okay, but she did, you know, probably a lot of work from her home, this and that. Okay. But remember I mentioned that she lived in Australia for a while? She moved to Australia in 1891. She was 64 years old when she moved there. Right? People go at the age of 65 going to retirement nowadays. Right? And now, let's remember that at that time, to move from America to Australia was not an easy task. It's not an easy task today, never mind at that time. Yet, at the age of 64, she went out to Australia, moved there to work. So again, we are never too old to work for the Lord. And my last thought I want to leave with is that there's a total of 70 years where she labored for the Lord. 70 years. Some people work for however many years, and they say, you know what, I've really worked, I've worked hard, I've done what I needed to. I think it's enough. But Ellen White, she worked 70 years until she passed away. So there's always something that we can do for the Lord. That's something that we should consider and perhaps put into our own lives. There's always something that we can do, and we can always, always be a light. This is my wish and prayer that we all understand and accept and do. Amen.
Thank you, Elena. Sister White is one of the missionaries that we talk the most about, and it's always nice to learn about who she really was. So now we've come to the final item of our young people's meeting this afternoon, and so I'd like to call up all the youth, and we're going to sing the youth song.